Come on, lift your hands.
And hell still knows. Abundant Life family, so glad you made it this morning. Here's what's going on at Abundant Life. God has been doing something amazing on these Wednesday nights. Be sure to stop by at 7 p.m. for worship and a powerful word. To all middle school and high school students, Thursday nights at 7 p.m. is the place to be. Don't forget to come out and invite a friend.
Have you guys been enjoying the messages God has been bringing? Well, be sure to check out our YouTube and podcast page to keep up with our latest sermons, and don't forget to share.
For more information, check us out online.
Like when Peter in the book of Acts, he had already begun proclaiming the gospel through the power of Jesus. He healed the man that was lame. The Bible says that Peter was filled with the Holy Spirit. And what he said was, Jesus, whom you crucified, is the chief cornerstone. And it's in his death and his resurrection that this man is now healed. And there is no other name unto salvation than the name of Jesus.
Happy Resurrection Day, church. Come on, King Jesus is here. He is risen. Won't you stand to your feet and worship with us? At home, we can't wait to worship with you. Come on.
He shames every idol. He reigns without rival. Goes by the name of Jehovah, Jehovah. He speaks into nothing, and darkness goes running. He goes by the name of Jehovah, Jehovah. Jehovah, all our praise, all our praise, all our praise belongs to Him.
All our praise belongs to Jesus.
His foes will be silenced. He's fighting for Zion. His eyes are like fire. There's no other God like.
Come on,
Jehovah.
What's his name?
Jehovah. Call the name. Call the name. Call the name. Jehovah.
All our praise.
All our praise. to so call the name.
Call the name.
Call the name.
Call the name. Call the name. Jehovah.
All our praise.
All our praise.
All our praise.
All our praise belongs to Him.
Jehovah Nissi, fight your battle. Jehovah Nissi, fight your battles. Yeah, come on.
Jehovah Nissi, fight your battles. Jehovah Nissi, fight your battles.
Yeah.
Jehovah Nissi, fight your battles.
Jehovah Jireh, meet your need.
Jehovah Jireh, meet your need.
Jehovah Rapha, heal your body.
Jehovah Rapha, heal your body.
Jehovah Shalom, be your peace. Come on.
Jehovah Shalom, be your peace.
Jehovah Nissi.
Jehovah Nissi, fight your battle.
Jehovah Jireh, meet your need.
Jehovah Jireh, meet your need.
Jehovah Rapha, heal your body.
Jehovah Rapha, heal your body.
Jehovah Shalom, be your peace.
Jehovah Shalom, be your peace. Jehovah Nissi, fight your battle.
Come on, say.
Jehovah Jireh, meet your need.
Jehovah Rapha, heal your body.
Jehovah Rapha, heal your body.
Jehovah Shalom, be your peace.
Jehovah Shalom,
come on,
be your
say,
peace.
To call the name.
Call the name. Call the name. Call the name. Jehovah. All
Call the doctor and the doctor said
said, I'm giving new life. Tell your enemies the victory is already here. More than 60,000 angels, just the tip of the spear. One day every knee will bow and every heart will be yours. This is the end of the war. Heaven is gone. You are the Lord.
Amen, amen. I don't know about you, but on Friday we came and we celebrated the fact that this man who was the Son of God and Son of Man came to the earth, was pierced, was bruised, was broken, was hung on that cross. On Saturday he was in the tomb. He was put in this tomb, and all the followers of Jesus didn't know if this man was actually the man that he said that he was. And there was a big question mark about Saturday. Is Jesus the one that he said that he is, right? And then there's Sunday. Ha! Today is Sunday. This is Sunday. Oh, come on. Give him some praise. Give him some praise. Give him some praise. Your God rose from the dead. Your King is seated high. Your deliverer has delivered you. Ha ha! Woo! Abundant Life, it's Easter Sunday. It's Resurrection Sunday. And the God that you serve is out of the grave. I said to myself, they're going to be sitting down, try to be calm. I just can't do it. I can't do it. He's risen. All these other gods, all these other religions, they had notable men. None of them came back from the grave. None of them on their own power was risen again. Your God, this Jesus, the one who you come to see today, is risen. Man, I get excited about that. I think about those two women on that Sunday morning, almost 2,000 years ago. Like, oh my gosh, this Jesus, let me go see. Let me go anoint his body. Let me go pay respects. When they went to that tomb, the angel was there shining like lightning. The soldiers were so scared because it was so intense. And they heard these words, "He's not here." He's risen. Today we serve a risen God. I don't know what in your life needs to know that your God is risen, but hear these words today. If you've been searching for truth, if you've been wondering what truth is, if you've been desiring to know what life is all about, if you really, really want to know the things that you should live for, if you really, really want to know the one that you should live for, my friends, my family, today I tell you the truth is here. Whew. All right, I'm going to stop. Let's talk about some announcements. Incredible things happening today. We've got a wonderful presentation for you, which I'll get to in just a second. But before I do, ways to give. How many know how to give in this house? Yeah. It's so awesome to be able to present more than just your time, more than just your talents, more than just your energy, but to be able to present your seed before the Lord. We don't have time to go into it deeply, but man, when you give your best to God, He always meets you with His best. That's not to be manipulated. That's not to mean anything other than serving the Lord with our tithe and offering is an incredible way that we worship Him. Second thing, there is no morning prayer on April 2nd. Somebody say, April 2nd. There is no prayer at church. But I'm going to pray. Keep saying it. I'm going to pray at home. Set your alarm for 5:55 because we're all going to pray. I'm just kidding. You don't have to do that. You don't have to do that. Next, we're not going to be having any next steps this week, but starting next week on April 7th, we're going to begin Next Steps. How many of y'all been through Next Steps? It's incredible. It's incredible. Next Steps is an amazing time where we see what's next for our lives here at this house. So if you're interested in that and you want to grow deeply with the Lord, be a part of that. The class is starting next week, not this week. Now, Wednesday nights. How many of y'all been a part of Wednesday nights? How many of y'all been a part of our glory nights? How many of y'all have seen the glory on glory nights? It's amazing. If you're able, if you can, be in this place on Wednesday nights. The atmosphere is charged in here today. On Wednesday, it's a whole nother vibe. Man, you get in there, you just want to love Jesus with your whole heart. You gotta try these glory nights. They're amazing, amazing, amazing. Okay, this is my most favorite announcement, and I'm gonna get out of your way and we'll continue with our service. But we have a very special group of young people that are coming to the stage. Give them a round of applause. We are going to be led in this next portion of our service by our incredible children's choir. So, without any further ado, can you give a rowdy round of applause for this kids' choir here?
Jesus, the one who came to save us, the one who came to redeem us, the one who came to change us, shift everything, because he loves us. I'm going to say it again. He loves you. I might say it one more time. God loves you. Jesus loves you. Y'all who are watching live, Jesus loves you.
Marvelous and holy, isn't delight in praise. Yes, you alone be honored and adored, and you alone be glorified in praise.
Yes, you alone will reign forevermore, and you alone have the name above all names. Yes, you alone will reign forevermore, and you alone have the name above all names.
Oh, oh. Come on, declare this Jesus.
This Jesus. This Jesus. Jesus, my Jesus, so wonderful, so beautiful, so kind and loving, isn't he, isn't he, beyond compare, treasure rich and rare. The glory and the honor of your name.
This is for you.
This is for you. glory and the honor of your face.
This praise, this worship,
this is for you.
It's for you, Jesus.
This is for you.
It's for you, God.
All for your glory and the honor of your name.
Hallelujah. We sing.
sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. The Lamb is on a cross. Forever He is glorified. Forever He is lifted high. Forever He is risen.
Thank you. Understand for some, this might be the first time that you're at church today. I know that this might be the first time that some of you are here with us at Abundant Life today, which we're so glad that you would make the decision to be with us here on Resurrection Sunday, this Easter Sunday. But this moment, as our hands are lifted high today, we come together and we lift up the mighty name of Jesus. The name that is above all names. There is no other name, because there is only one name. And so we exalt you today, Lord. We bless you today, Father. We thank you today, Lord Jesus. We thank you that you are the risen King. We thank you that in you we live and move and have our being. We thank you that in you that we have life, the abundant life that comes from you. That's the promise. And so we worship you today, Lord. We magnify your name today. And Father, I thank you that everyone under the sound of my voice today, that the way that we came in is not the way that we're going to leave. Lord, I thank you. I thank you that you made a way for us. You love us as we are, enough not to leave us the way that we are. But Lord, you've got better and greater for your people. And so today we speak Jesus over every life, over the families, over our community. We declare nothing broken, nothing missing, nothing lost. Father, we thank you today. We go from faith to faith. Lord, we go from glory to glory, from strength to strength. I declare in the mighty name of Jesus, salvation to fill the room today. I declare in the mighty name of Jesus, sickness has to go. I declare in the mighty name of Jesus, freedom in the house today. I declare in the mighty name of Jesus, peace and joy that is everlasting. Today, Father, we declare these things in your name. And we give you glory in that. And we give you honor in that. And we give you praise. Amen and amen. If you love Jesus, let them know. Tell them how much you love him. Are you thankful for him? While you're still standing and while everyone's here, we just wanted to take a moment this morning and welcome you and greet you. And I'm going to hand you back the mic to welcome and greet everybody one more time.
Good morning. It's Easter Sunday. Welcome to church. I hope you came ready, man, because we have got a fire service. I mean, if what you already haven't seen is not fire, I mean, I don't know, but it gets better and better and better. I am so thankful for you guys coming here, giving Jesus a little bit of your time today as we celebrate his resurrection, man. It is Easter Sunday. This is the main event. This is why we have what we have. This is why we have life and have it more abundantly. This is why we believe that God is good. He loves us and he wants to bless us. That is who God is. So I hope you get to know him a little bit more today. For those of you that don't know me, my name's Erin. I'm one of the pastors here. I'm his wife. But hey, if you're joining us online, welcome. We are so glad that you are part of our church family today. Listen, it's going to be a great day. So y'all buckle your seatbelts, and here we go.
And I'm her husband. We have this great joy and honor and privilege to be able to lead and pastor this house along with many other amazing men and women, but it's the privilege, it's the honor that we get to continue to steward what the Lord is doing at Abundant Life. And so there's not one person here today that's here by accident or mistake. And whether it's your first time or whether you've been holding it down for a long time, you are family. You are family. And my wife has already said it, but we declare this and we believe it and know it to be true, that God is a good God, that God does love you, and God wants to bless you. And I'd like to encourage you this morning just to let somebody know next to you today that God is a good God. Tell them God loves you today. And tell them that God wants to bless you. Amen. Well, why don't we give the Lord some praise one more time this morning? As you're seated today, let them know again, we're better together. Tell somebody we're better together. We're better together in Jesus' name. Hey, can you also tell the worship team? And I know what they already dismissed, but our kids' choir, what? How wonderful was that? I'm so thankful and appreciative of the anointing that our teams carry, our worship team, our band, and of course, all of the different moments that we've had this morning. And we're not here for entertainment. We're not here for production. We're here to seek Jesus. And I'm thankful that our heart's posture is to just come before the Lord. And that's what I believe every day should always be about. And of course, particularly on Easter Sunday, we're here for one purpose in mind. And it's not what my daughter said this morning, the Easter eggs, although those are nice for the kids and for the adults, depending on what type of candy's in the egg. I don't want that taffy junk. I want the chocolate. I know it melts, but still, it's just so much better. No, but we're here to lift up the name of Jesus. There's something about Easter Sunday when we come together. My heart is moved because it's this moment that as we gather, we're focusing on Sunday morning on not that he is just Jesus, but that he is Jesus Christ. He's Christ our Lord, Christ our King. He is risen. He is the resurrection. He came into this earth and did what not one person in this room, not one person in this city, not one person in the county, not one person in the state, in the nation, or around the world could do. He did what no one could do, but yet he did it for you and for me. And it moves my heart every day when I wake up thinking about his goodness and his faithfulness. I remember that song, When I Think About the Lord. Probably should have had you not even get off the stage. No, I'm serious. I feel like I want to just, can we sing that song? Thank you, Pastor Jenya. It's an oldie but a goodie. She had to run around the back to come back out. She probably had to grab the microphone. But there's a song that says, remember when I think about the Lord, I know I'm catching you on the fly with this, but I feel stirred in my spirit about it. I got a little worship still inside of me that I just want to give to the Lord today. But he says, when I think about the Lord and how he saved me and how he changed me and how he healed me, how he picked me up and he turned me around, how he set my feet on. Oh, y'all know the song too. Oh, I'm not the only one.
It's been
just stirring in my heart. The last, I think, 24, 48 hours, something like that. And I just begin to think about that, how he put me on solid ground. The Bible says that my steps are ordered of the Lord. You're not here by accident or mistake. The Lord's got a purpose and a plan and a future for your life. Your best days are the ones that are ahead of you and not behind you. I'm not preaching the message. Don't worry, we'll get there. I'm just feeling stirred in my heart because I'm reminded about how faithful my God is. And I just feel like if we could just sing that this morning.
When I think about the Lord, how he saved me, how he raised me, how he filled me with the Holy Ghost, how he healed me to the uttermost. When I think about the Lord, how he picked me up, he turned me around, how he placed my feet. Think about the Lord, how he saved me, how he raised me, how he filled me with the Holy Ghost, how he healed me to the uttermost. When I think about the Lord, how he picked me up, he turned me around, how he placed my feet on solid ground.
You know it, come on.
It makes me want to shout,
come on.
Hallelujah, thank you, Jesus. Lord, you're worthy of all the glory, all of the honor, and all of the praise.
It makes me
want to shout.
Oh,
hallelujah, thank you, Jesus. Lord, you're worthy of all the glory, all of the honor, and all of the praise.
It makes me want to shout.
Makes me want to shout.
Oh,
hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, you're worthy.
Let me tell you why this is so strong in my spirit this morning. Because I have witnessed and have lived this, that in moments that I was far from God and should have never even had the opportunity to encounter God because of where my life was, but in my brokenness, He came in and brought healing to my life. Out of His love, out of His mercy, out of His grace. Not that I have time for it, but there was a moment earlier on in my life that I had gotten so far away from God, and I grew up in the church. Oh, I knew how to close my eyes and lift my hands and how to shout like with all the best of the other Christians, but the reality was on the inside, I was so disconnected from the things of God. I felt like my life had to measure up to others, and as a result, I found myself running far away to the point I actually moved to another country. But in the middle of my mess, in the middle of my brokenness, in the middle of my confusion, the Lord met me one morning. And He began to encourage me and tell me that He said, Sean, your life is not about measuring up to others. Your life is about knowing that I love you and I'm with you. See, He turned my life around. I know what it is to be in a hard moment of life to feel like I've lost everything. And we've shared this testimony, but back years ago when my wife and I, when we wanted to have our family and she got pregnant and then miscarried, we had a decision to make. Am I gonna sit there and curse the Lord, or am I gonna sit there and say, you're still faithful, you still sit on the throne, you're still a good God? And we had to make a decision, and our decision was that we weren't going to sit there and get upset at God, but we were going to sit there and we were going to declare His goodness. And as a result, we stand here today with two beautiful children because He's faithful. I said He's faithful. I know what it is to come up in a house and my parents, them to go through difficulties in their physical body. I shared this on Good Friday. My mother was diagnosed with cancer, and she had a decision to make. Either she was going to accept it or she was going to tell the doctor, I will live and not die. Her confession was on the ladder, and guess what? She's standing here today. There's something about knowing that God is good and that He is faithful. We're not here to be entertained. We're not here for religious purposes. We're here to know and to recognize that He is the resurrection, the way, the truth, and the life. And so when I think about the Lord and how He saved me and how He changed me and how He picked me up and He turned me around because of His faithfulness today. Oh, I don't know, maybe you've got about 20 seconds just to let Him know how good He is, how faithful He is.
It makes me want to shout, hallelujah, thank you, Jesus, Lord, you're worthy of all the glory, all the honor, and all the praise.
Business to handle really quick. Deafness in the right ear. There's been some deafness in the right ear. I'm just opening up the room for a moment this morning. I feel the tangible touch for the Lord. Just stretch your hand high if there's been some deafness in your right ear. I want to give this moment right now. I see a hand back over there. There's two hands right now. I know there was one specifically. I want you to come down front really quick. It's in the right ears. That's what the Lord began to show me last night as I was praying, that there's deafness in a right ear. Why not the left? I don't know. He said right here, to be specific. I believe he can touch the right and the left. I'm just being obedient this morning. I know some of you are here this morning to say, what in the world is going on? Listen, we believe that Jesus is our healer. And by his stripes that we are healed. Church, just do me a favor this morning. Just stir your faith up real quick in prayer. Let's just begin to pray right now. Let's just begin to pray right now. Let's just begin to get our faith sharp. Thank you, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord, you're not the author of deafness. But Father, I thank you, Lord, in the mighty name of Jesus. God, if you can cause blind eyes to open, if you can cause the mute to speak, the lame to walk, then Lord, we thank you. We thank you, Lord, in the mighty name of Jesus.
Started feeling a lump in my left breast, and it was significantly big, and I was just worried. I went to the doctor, and she checked me out, and she felt it as well. So she said, I'm going to have you go get a mammogram, sonogram. And when I called to make the appointment, they said, well, we can't see you until the end of January. And I said, well, you know what? That's perfect. Because I'm about to go on this fast, and I'm believing God that whatever that is, it's going to dissolve in Jesus' name. And then on top of that, for the past year, I had this reoccurring rash on my neck, and I had tried all cutting out different things, and it just kept coming back. And I said, God, I know that you can heal me from this rash, from the lump. It's going to be gone in Jesus' name. So I put all my prayer thoughts, all my trust in the Lord during that fast. And I would say about the second week, I felt that that lump was getting smaller and smaller and smaller. And I said, Jesus, once this lump is gone, I'm going to go back to that doctor and I'm going to testify that you healed me. So I went, got the test done at the end of the month, and I, as the lady was doing the sonogram, I said, you do this every day, right? She's like, yeah. I'm like, I feel like the lump that was there is gone. I said, do you see anything? She's like, I don't see anything. I said, well, glory to God, because now I get to go testify to my doctor. So I quickly set up an appointment, went to meet with the doctor, sat down, and I said, doctor, you remember that huge lump that was there that you felt? She's like, I do. And I'm like, it's gone. It, in Jesus' name, it's gone. I said, I went on a fast with my church. I believe God that he would do it. And he did. I said, I just believe that God is a powerful God. And she started saying, well, what kind of fast did you do? And, oh, yes, it's good to put that positive energy. I said, no, it's Jesus. Jesus did it. Jesus, all for his glory. And the rash was gone.
That got me so stirred up. We had the privilege to hear this testimony earlier this week, and it just got me so stirred up because it was on her confession.
Yeah.
On her confession. See, there's something that's about when you make a confession, your confession. The Bible says in the book of Hebrews, let us hold fast to our confession of faith. And when I hold fast to him, he holds fast to you because he is faithful. Yeah. I'm going to say that again. When you hold fast to him, he holds fast to you because he is faithful. When I think about the Lord and how he saved me, how he healed me. If you just need a touch from heaven in your body today, just place your hands on your heart today and say, Lord, I thank you that I am healed in the mighty name of Jesus. I hold fast to you, Lord, in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. And amen. Now let's give the Lord some praise again in this place this morning. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. All right, why don't we go ahead and get seated? Let's do this thing. I just wanted to get our faith stirred this morning on Easter Sunday. I'm sorry, I just think too many times we, you know, a lot of people want to, you know, do these in and out Easter Sunday, you know, services, and I don't treat Easter Sunday in the sense that it's any different than any other Sunday. I come in with expectation that the Lord's going to save, he's going to heal, he's going to deliver. The only difference is many of you that normally don't come to church on Sunday happen to join us on Easter Sunday, and I love it because y'all are a good-looking group of people. That's an opportunity for you to say amen. Pastor said that you're a good-looking group of people. All right, I receive it. Y'all got up early this morning, getting your hair done, steaming your clothes, ironing your clothes. Maybe some of you prepared weeks in advance. You knew Easter Sunday is coming. Get our church hats out. God bless the church hats. And the laced gloves. If you are wearing some laced gloves, I welcome it. It's awesome. I think that's still a thing. I know you got a pair. You didn't bring them this morning. Oh, Lord, I love Jesus. Do you? Amen. Amen. I want to just turn our attention this morning. We're going to look at two passages. And as we examine these two passages, we're going to work backwards a little bit. But in doing so, we're going to land on what we were just declaring, what we were just speaking, and that is our confession is that he is Jesus Christ, our Lord, that he is the Son of the living God. And so if we can, I would like to look this morning in the book of Luke chapter 24, and I want to put our attention on few lines of text in chapter 24, and then if you're taking notes and following along, we're going to jump over to Matthew 16, and we're going to bring these two passages together. But in Luke 24, starting off in the first verse, and I want to read this portion of the story all together. I want to keep the continuity of it so that we can see how this thing takes place. But in Luke 24, verse 1, it says this: "But on the first day of the week, at early dawn, they went to the tomb, taking spices they had prepared, and they found the stone rolled away." Y'all see that? Stone was rolled away. And the Bible says that as the stone was rolled away from the tomb, but when they went in, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were perplexed about this, behold, two men stood by them in dazzling apparel. Like, when I read that, I'm going to TM that right there. I feel like that's just like a new Christian, you know, like clothing line, dazzling apparel. Watch out. You're going to start getting ads online about this thing. I'm surprised no one's done that yet. Here they are in dazzling apparel. "And as they were frightened and bowed their faces to the ground, the men said to them," these are the angels, "and they said to them, 'Why do you seek the living among the dead? He is not here, but he is risen.'" I love that statement. Why do you look for what is alive amongst what is dead? And I don't know how many times I come across people that for some reason they feel like they got to go back to dead places, dead spaces, and to dead things, thinking that there is still life in what is already dead and done. He is alive. But yet for some reason we feel like we got to go back to dead relationships, thinking that Jesus might still be in that thing. We got to go back to dead seasons of our lives, thinking that maybe there was something that we still needed to learn or to gain from it. Why do you look for the living amongst the dead? He is alive, which means he is ahead of you. He is speaking to your future, not to your past. I better stay on point this morning. I don't want to let the hounds loose just yet. This is not what I'm preaching, but I get excited when I see that, because the living God is the one that's always looking at what is ahead of you, not what's behind you. The dead things are the things that's of the past. The dead things is where the devil will try and get you distracted and make you think that you got to go back and mourn on what is done. And I'm always reminded about the passage in 1 Samuel when Saul had sinned and the prophet Samuel would begin to mourn, and the Lord said, "Stop your whining, stop your crying. Go fill your horn with oil, because the king that I have for my people is ahead, not behind. The Lord is anointing you for the days that are ahead of you, not what is behind you, because he is Christ, the risen. He is living." And so the Bible, it goes on and it says, "Remember how he told you when he was still in Galilee that the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified, and on the third day that he would rise." And in verse 8 it says, "And they remembered his words." This is important because the angel is bringing to these individuals, which was three ladies that had come to go to the tomb, and they see that the tomb is open, but the tomb is empty. And these angels, they encounter them, and they remind these women about the fact of what Jesus said, that he was going to be crucified, but then in 3 days he would rise. The Bible says in 1 John chapter 3, in verse 8, well, excuse me, in verses 5 and 8, that he came to remove the sins of the world, and he came to destroy the works of the devil. There is two reasons why Jesus appeared, why he came to this earth, and that was to take away the sins of the world, is what he accomplished on the cross. But to destroy the works of the devil is what took place in the grave, and when he rose 3 days later, it was the destruction of every dark, demonic thing that the devil would try to have on your life. He is the God that is living. Two things that he came for: to take away the sins. And I want to park it on that for a moment, because there's many of us that on Easter Sunday, you know, we come, and for some of us, we allow this to be a moment that we're all the areas that we've missed it and we've messed up in life, and we on Easter Sunday, we want to get it right in a hopes that that will atone me until the next Easter Sunday when I come back to church again. But I'm here to tell you is that when you confess that he is Jesus Christ, the Lord over your life through the finished work of the cross, that you are saved, that you are set free, and that you don't have to go back to that old life. And you can't allow the guilt, the shame, the nonsense to try and be, if you would, just dangled in front of you, because that's what the devil does. He wants you to think that you might have said something, but you'll never change. But that's why he conquered the grave, and that's why he rose, was to destroy the very works of the devil. Every lie, every plan, everything that the devil would try to conjure up to keep you from purpose and destiny, Jesus destroyed that junk so that you could walk in freedom, that you could walk with authority. And the angel is reminding these women as they're there at the tomb, and the Bible says that they remembered. And so what do? They go back and they run to the house where all the other disciples were, and the story continues, and it says that in verse 9, in returning from the tomb, that they told all of these things to the 11 and to all the rest. Now it was Mary Magdalene and Joanna and Mary the mother of James and the other women who were with them that told them these things to the apostles. But I want you to see this in verse 11, but these words seemed to them an idle tale. They come back and they say, you're not going to believe this. And they're telling the disciples, the one who was close with Jesus, the one who witnessed the miracles, the one who saw him do great and mighty things in the earth, the one who they did life with. They come back and they say, he is not in the tomb. He's gone. He is risen. But yet those that were amongst him and close with him, that walked with him, said, this is but an idle tale. An idle tale means they said, this is nonsense. There's no way. How could it be? And my question is, how could it be that you could be so close to Jesus, to hear the words of Jesus, and to be doing life with him for the 3+ years of ministry he was on the earth? And how many times did he say that he was going to suffer at the hands of man, that he was going to be crucified on the cross, but as he is killed, that in 3 days he would rise again? How many times did he make these statements among them, but yet here they are and they're in disbelief? But I can tell you why they're in disbelief, and it's for one simple thing, one simple reason. They got close to Jesus, but they never made a confession. And so the story closes out this portion of text, and it says, but these words seemed to them as an idle tale, and they did not believe him. But in verse 12, but Peter rose. Peter ran to the tomb, stooping down and looking in. He saw the linen clothes by themselves, and he went home marveling at what had happened. And I believe in this moment, as he went and he saw that Jesus was no longer in the tomb, in this moment, he was reaffirmed about a statement and a confession that he had made. As he looked and saw the empty tomb, he marveled. I could see him. Christ now is no longer there. And him saying, oh my goodness, I can't believe he did it. I knew he was going to do it. I knew it. I knew it. And knowing Peter, he was probably walking around saying, yeah, look, I did. I remember I made a statement that we're about to read. I made this statement. Guys, look. He marveled because in the core, in the inside, in his heart, he had made a confession. See, I want to tell you this morning, before I even jump into Matthew's gospel, is that you can get close to Jesus, but if you don't make a confession, nothing's going to change. And there's many people that get close to Jesus in different moments throughout the year because the holiday season is just a great time that we can have church, and I love it. I'm glad that every single one of you are here this morning, but we can get close to him but never know him. We can come and be spiritual, but the Bible says that you can be spiritual all you want, but if you don't know him, it's not going to do anything. It's in the confession. It's in the words that you speak. It's in the declaration of your heart. What is your confession? Peter's confession, we find it in Matthew's gospel, and I want to just read this passage really quick, and this is where we will spend the remainder of our time today. And the Bible says this in Matthew chapter 16, and in verse 13. Now when Jesus came into the district of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say the Son of Man is?" And they said, "Some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, others say Jeremiah, or one of the prophets." But then he said to them, "Who do you say that I am?" And if I can stop right there and just pose that as a question, I just jotted this down as my title for our time together. Jesus is asking the question, "Who do you say that I am?" And as we read this passage, verse 16, Simon Peter replied and he says, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." And Jesus answered him, "Blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it." I want to stop right there. I know that there is more to the statement, but I want to stop it right there. Jesus takes the disciples to Caesarea Philippi, and while he is there, he asks them this question: "Who do people say that I am?" What's the conversation that is to be had of the Son of Man in regards to who he is? And they start rattling off different mighty men of God throughout the Bible, and they say John the Baptist, and they say Elijah, and they say Jeremiah. All of these were anointed men of God that was preparing the way. But the reality is this, is that Jesus is not that, because he is the way. And so he's asking this and they're responding. What's the tone? What is culture? What is society? What are they talking about when it comes to who the Son of Man is? But I think the thing that we gotta draw our attention to is that it wasn't just the question that Jesus asked, but it was where he asked the question that allows us to understand the significance of this story. He brings them to Caesarea Philippi. Caesarea Philippi, this location is on the outskirts. It's on the edge. It's on the threshold, the transition point from where the people of God live and where all idolatry and wickedness and paganistic practices take place. He brings them all the way to the edge and he says, "Look out here in Philippi. You see what all these people are doing. You see all these sacrifices and worship that they are giving to all these other gods. You see all of this wickedness and sin and things that are happening." He brings them all the way out there, which, by the way, for Jesus to lead his disciples out there was almost a suicide mission in and of itself, because if you were caught in Philippi and you were known to be a Jew who practiced walking in worshiping the Lord, you would have been an outcast. In fact, in some instances, they would have stoned you and killed you. And here's Jesus, and this is the severity that he's bringing to the attention of the disciples. He brings them all the way to the end of the line, and he says, "You see all this out here? This is where all of these different practices and worship and things are. Am I just another God like these that they are worshiping?" See, I want to tell you is that Jesus cannot just be another God and another thing that you worship. Jesus is not someone that you pick up at the buffet line after service today. You can't go and have a little bit of idolatry and have a little bit of Jesus Christ. You can't go in and have a little bit of adultery and have a little bit of Jesus. You can't go in and have a little bit of pornography and have a little bit of Jesus. You can't go in, have a little bit of drugs and alcohol and addiction and have a little bit of Jesus. It don't work like that. And I think that's what the Lord is speaking to his church today. And I believe that's the message that the Lord wants the world to know today. Where do you stand with me and what is your confession? The Bible says if you confess him before men, he will confess you before the Father. And it's really hard to make a firm confession when you're allowing your life to entertain anything and everything the world has to offer. Jesus is not a side dish. He's the main meal. He's the only piece. You don't get Jesus in anything else. There is only one name, and that is Jesus Christ. And so he brings him to the edge of the city, and he's saying, I want to know. I want to know. What do you all say about me? What is the conversation? So they're listing off all of these different people. But Peter steps up and he makes a confession. I want to tell you this. Do you know that in 2023, that on the internet, Jesus was searched over 630 million times? On the internet, online. What that tells me is that there is a broken world out there that is looking for an answer. Over 630 million, over a half a billion searches online inquiring about who is Jesus. The world is wondering, who is this man? Who is the great I am? And Peter, he steps up and he says, you are the Christ. You're the Son of the Living. Jesus asks all the disciples and he says, what's the conversation? But Peter says, I'm not here for conversation. I'm here for a confession. And I want to encourage you that we got to stop having conversations and we need to start making confessions. Conversation does not get you into the kingdom. And hear me, I'm not saying don't have conversation and talk about the Lord and be a witness. But what I'm saying is enough playing games, having conversations around, well, who is Jesus and what is he? No, it's time to make a confession to be definitive about it. For you to know what you are supposed to do and do it not is sin. And the word sin means to miss the mark. And many of us will miss the mark because we don't stand firm on our confession. And Peter is steadfast in his confession, and he says that you are Christ, the Son of the Living. Now, Christ is not Jesus' last name. Christ means the anointed one, the Messiah. And he doesn't just say you're Jesus. He says that you're Jesus, the Christ, the anointed one. The Bible says that the anointing is what breaks the yoke of bondage off of our life, according to Isaiah. So when I am making my confession, I'm declaring that it is Jesus who is the anointing to break off every foul and demonic, every trick of the devil, so that I can live this free life that comes in Christ and Christ alone. For whom the Son sets free, help me out, is free. That's on your confession. And so Jesus is there, and Peter, he makes this confession that you are the Christ. Now, growing up in my house, if my parents needed to get my attention, they would say, Sean. Now, if they didn't get my attention right away, they would use my first name, which, by the way, my first name's actually not Sean. My first name is Richard. Now, y'all don't be calling me Richard now. I don't hear nobody call me no Lil Ricky. No bueno. I ain't playing that. And I'm not a junior.
but my first name is Richard. When we leave from here, y'all leave that down in the books. That don't need to be resurrected. But if they needed my attention, they would say Sean. But if they didn't get my attention, they would say Richard Sean. And if they got part of my attention, needed all of my attention, they would call me Richard Sean Thomas. Now, I do the same thing in my household. When I want my son's name, or when I want my son's attention, I'll say Oakley. That's his middle name. His first name is Sean. I'm just paying it forward. And so, so when I want his attention, I'll say Oakley. And if I don't get his undivided attention, I say Sean Oakley. And when I am like just steadfast in needing to get my boy to recognize my voice, I say Sean Oakley Thomas. Now, while we joke and we laugh about that, there's something important to know that when you speak the name of God, you get his full undivided attention. You are Jesus Christ, the Lord, the Son of the living God. Okay. There is something about when you declare who he is. So in my household, when I declare who my son and my daughter, who my wife, myself, and I'm not talking about getting their attention, but when I declare that we're a child of the Most High God, when I declare that we're victorious in Christ Jesus, it's because I know it, I believe it, and I'm walking in it. I don't just flippantly throw around Jesus. I wake up and I make my declaration, I make my confession that you are Christ the Lord, the Son of the living. Now, upon his confession, Jesus says this. He says that you are Peter. The word or the name Peter, it comes from the Greek word Petrus, which means a stone. And he says, Peter, upon this rock, meaning Jesus, I will build my church. Jesus did not build his church on Peter. He used Peter to build his church on him. For theology purposes, that's a freebie. He says, Peter, you're a stone, and upon the living stone, I will build my church. You're a stone, and upon the living stone, you will now be a part of building my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail. Now, how many times have we heard that, and we think, like, hell's going to try and, like, whoom, overtake us? They don't mean that. Hell's under your feet, by the way. Hell don't come up out of the ground. Hell's underneath you. The idea, the understanding what Jesus is saying is this. When you know who you are in me as Christ your Lord, anything the enemy tries to make you feel intimidated with, I've destroyed the works. You have the authority to know that the gates of hell cannot conquer you, but you conquer it. It's not about hell overtaking you. It's about you knowing your right as a child of God, as a believer, as one that confesses Christ, that I have authority in Christ Jesus. It says the gates of hell shall not prevail. In fact, where Philippi was, by the way, just to give you even more context, because you asked this morning. Before Philippi was Philippi, way back in the Old Testament, the region and the area where Philippi was at was actually where the tribe of Dan inhabited. There was 12 tribes, and I don't have time to go through all of the historical background of this, but there are 12 tribes that set up in the Promised Land, and one of the tribes was called Dan. And in the tribe of Dan, there was a group of people that represented this tribe, and they inhabited this land of where now it's known what we read as Philippi. But when they were there, here's where they got into problems. The problem was this, is that they didn't stand on the promises of God, but they welcomed in other idolatry. And because they welcomed in other idolatry, there came a point in time that no one even knew who God was in that land. And so here's Jesus leading the disciples, and he's saying, you need to make a decision. Either you're all in for me or not, because if you're not, the gates of hell, which was a region in Philippi, it was this big cave known as the gates of Hades. He's saying, you're just going to end up in there like everybody else. So what's your confession today? What's your confession today? And Peter steps up and he says that you are the Christ. You're the Son of the living God. What's your confession today? If I were to just take a few more moments this morning, what's your confession today? Who do you say that he is? As we leave from here today, I want that to be something that rests in your heart and your mind. Who do you say that Jesus is? He says, who do you say that I am? Who do you say that he is? It's amazing when you think about the Bible is made up of 66 books. Yet it's not known as a book, it's known as the Word. 66 books, but it's represented in a word because he is the Word. At 1 John, he says that he was the Word, and the Word was with God, and he was with him in the beginning, and all things that consisted by him and from him, everything that exists. He's not just a new thing that arrived on the scene right here with the disciples. He always has, he always will, and he always will continue to be. He is eternal in everything. Who do you say that I am? He is the Alpha, he is the Omega, he's the first, he is the last. See, long before you even sat down in these chairs, the Lord already knew who you were. He already spoke into reality who you are. And he spoke over you and confessed who you were. And the question is, who do you confess that he is? He's the one that gives life. And the greatest promise is that we can have the abundant life that comes in him and him alone. He is eternal. Y'all, do you understand this? Do you understand that when Jesus died on the cross and when he went to hell and destroyed the works of darkness, what it took for him to get into hell? I think this is one of the most fascinating and mind-blowing realities and revelation is that Jesus, sinless, could never get into hell. He can't get into hell. Have you ever tried to get into a building or a business and you did not have clearance? If you did, I wonder what you're doing. Did I catch you? You ever showed up somewhere and you know that you don't belong, but you're trying to figure out how to get in? And unless if you are wearing, or unless if you have on something that says that I belong and I can get in, if I don't have that, I'm not getting in. Jesus took on all the sins of humanity, our sins, and he used this as a disguise to Mission Impossible himself into the depths, into hell. No one saw him coming. That's why I think it's the greatest just plan that God ever had. Up his sleeves, the devil's looking every season of life. What's God's plan going to be? The Lord's always got one more move. And here's Jesus. He dies on the cross. He takes on all the sin, and he is disguised, and he is going straight into hell. They didn't even see him coming. And when he gets there, he begins to preach to the captives, and he begins to declare, see, I am the Christ. And he destroys the works of darkness, and he comes back. And that's why this passage finishes off by him saying, and now, Peter, the keys that I have, I place in your hand. All authority, it's in your hand. I'm here to tell you, in your confession, all authority is back in your hands when you confess that Jesus Christ is Lord over your life. Sickness cannot stay. Brokenness cannot stay. Defeat cannot stay. Lack cannot stay. It can't stay because he accomplished too much on the cross for you to have to live anything less than his best, anything less than what his word says. It would be uncruel if there was another way to God outside of Jesus. Think about that. It'd be totally, totally inhumane and uncruel, which already what was done to him was inhumane. But it would be totally cruel if there was another way to God, but there's not. And he says, I am the way, I am the truth, and I am the life. And no one can come to the Father except through me. This abundant life, this life that God has for you, it comes from him. He is eternal. He is everlasting. And every time the devil would try to show up, the Lord would present himself and he would show out. Jesus is ageless and endless. And when you make your confession, you unlock the living word in every area of your life. Who do you say that he is? He's asking us the question, who do you say? that I am. I know that I say that in Genesis, He is our Creator. He's the seed of woman. He's the tree of life. In Exodus, He's our Passover lamb. In Leviticus, He's our high priest. In Numbers, He's a cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night. In Deuteronomy, He's the everlasting covenant that when you abide in Him, His blessing stands for your life forevermore. In Joshua, He's the captain of the Lord's armies. In Judges, He's your deliverer. In Ruth, He's the kinsman redeemer. In 1 Samuel, man, He's a giant slayer. In 2 Samuel, He's an anointed king. In 1 Kings, He is the temple of glory. Think about this. In 2 Kings, He's a powerful prophet. In 1 and 2 Chronicles, He is the house of David. In Ezra, He's a rebuilder of the temple. In Nehemiah, He's a rebuilder of the walls. In Esther, He's a protector of God's people. That's who I say that He is. In Job, He's a mediator between God and man. In Psalms, He's your good shepherd. In Proverbs, He is our wisdom. In Ecclesiastes, He gives meaning to your life. In Song of Solomon, He's a faithful lover. That's who I say that my Jesus is. That's what I confess. In Isaiah, He is the Prince of Peace. And in Jeremiah, He is the Savior of Israel. That's who I say that He is. Who do you say that I am? In Lamentations, He's the weeping Messiah. I want this just to settle down. He was weeping for us when we were far from Him. But yet, out of His tears, out of His ability to give of Himself for us, now He wipes every tear from our eye. Who do you confess that He is? In Ezekiel, He is the Son of Man who speaks to dry bones, come alive again. In Daniel, He's the fourth man in the fire. This was fun the other day. I was trying to teach my daughter about Good Friday, and I said, did you know that Jesus died on the cross? She said, yeah, He died on the cross for Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. I said, what about everybody else? Them too, Daddy. He's the fourth man in the fire. He's the fourth man in the fire because when you're bold for Him, He's bold for you. You see in this? Hosea, He's a faithful husband. Joel, He's the outpouring of the Spirit in the last days. And Amos, He's a burden bearer. This is who I say that He is. The Bible says that His yoke is easy and His burden is light. Cast your cares upon Him. This is who I confess my Christ, my Jesus, to be. So you got to make it personal. And if it's not personal, and if it's not a confession, and if it's not from your heart, then we can miss everything that God has and who He is for our life. Who do you confess Him to be? Obadiah, He becomes our judge. In Micah, He is just, He is merciful. In Jonah, He is the great missionary. In Nahum, He's a proclaimer of peace. In Habakkuk, He crushes all injustice. So now let me tell you, for every offense and everything that's been done against you, He gets the final say over your life, church. He has the final say. Zephaniah, He is a warrior who saves. In Haggai, He restores all worship. In Zechariah, He is the coming Christ, the coming King. In Malachi, He is the Son of our righteousness. That's who I say that He is. Who do you confess Him to be? In Matthew, He is the Messiah. And Mark, he's a wonder worker. And I've seen wonderful works by my God. I testify to it personally, and we testified about it earlier. Luke, he's the Son of Man, and in John, he's the Son of God, the Word in flesh. Acts, he's the Holy Spirit. In Romans, he's our justifier. In 1 Corinthians, he's your sanctifier. In 2 Corinthians, he's the gifts of the Spirit. But in Galatians, he is the fruit of the Spirit. That's who I confess him to be. In Ephesians, he is the head of his church. Philippians, he's the supplier of all your needs. Why should you go through life in lack when he is the supplier of all your needs according to his riches and glory? Thank God I'm on heaven's economy system. Colossians, he takes preeminence in all things because everything consists with him and everything exists from him. And first in 2 Thessalonians, he's the returning king. And in 1 and 2 Timothy, he is a leader of leaders. He is a pastor of pastors. In Micah, he is a faithful pastor. Titus, he's a faithful pastor. Philemon, he's the returning king. He's coming back, guys. Who do you confess him to be? I know who I confess him to be. I confess him to be the perfecter of my faith in Hebrews. I confess him to be the great physician in James. Do you know the book of James says if you need wisdom, ask from him and he will give it liberally? So if you ever feel like you're stuck in life, confess your wisdom that comes in Christ Jesus. He makes a way where it looks like there's no way. First and Second Peter, man, he's a refiner's fire. He strips away everything that's impure and he strengthens you to reflect him. Isn't that beautiful? First, Second, and Third John, he is our love. He loves you. And that's why he accomplished what he accomplished on the cross and in the grave for you and for me. And Jude, he defended us and kept us from stumbling so that in Revelation you could stand up and declare that he is King of Kings, that he is Lord of Lords. Who do you confess him to be? Who do you confess him to be? David confessed him as a slingshot. Gideon confessed him as a sword. In the Garden of Eden, he's confessed as the tree of life. He's Noah's rainbow, guys. Our promise, our reminder. Not whatever the world says that the rainbow is, but what God said that it was. He's Joseph's coat of many colors. He's Peter's rock. He's Paul's handkerchief. He's Hezekiah's sundial. He's a way in the wilderness and a stream in the desert. That's who I confess my Christ to be. He is the way. He is the truth. He is the life. He's been my healer. He's been my restorer. He's been my redeemer. And he continues to be. Because he is Christ, my confession. But I believe that the Lord is asking us today, who do you say that I am? Who do you confess him to be? I call him Jesus. I call him the Christ. I call him the Son of the living God. We don't serve a dead God. We serve a living God who is able. Who is able. Who is able. I'll throw you one more scripture right now because I'm stirred in my heart about this. I love Ephesians 3:20. Now he is able to do exceedingly and abundantly all that we ask or think, according to his power, resurrecting power, resurrection power that's at work within us. When I confess him, I got resurrection power on my side, that I know that in my walk with the Lord, in my confession, I am victorious and I am strong and I am a conqueror and I am made whole. That's who I confess my Jesus to be. Your confession is the key to your victory. Your confession is the key to your victory. So who do you confess him to be? I call you Jesus, King of kings and Lord of lords. He doesn't want some of your life. He wants to be Lord over all of your life. I want to extend in just an invitation right now that if you have not made a confession to declare that Christ is the King of kings and the Lord of lords over your life, you say, Pastor, I've been struggling and I'm hearing this word today, but I know that I can't go back to what was. Today I'm making my confession of faith. I got to declare Christ as my Savior, as my King, as my Lord. If I'm speaking to you this morning, I'm not doing heads bowed. I'm not doing eyes closed. I think if we can be public about acting sinful around the world, then we can be public about confessing who Christ is before one another. If you say, Pastor, that's me this morning, I want you to come down front today. We're declaring that he is Christ. He's our confession. He's the hope of humanity. He's the one that takes the sins away. He's the one that redeems. He's the one that sets free. He is the great I am. He is the one that says that every knee will bow in heaven, in earth, and under earth, which means even Satan will bow his knee and lift up his voice and declare that Christ is King. Why? Because he destroyed the works of darkness. Who do you say that I am? Who do you say that I am? I refuse. To allow anything in my life to keep me disconnected from God. You say, but Pastor, you don't understand. I've gone through so many things. Well, so did all of those 66 books of the Bible, which is the living word. Here's the deal. You know why I love all of this? As I was reading it through, the Lord was putting it in my heart. He said, Tell the people that I'm the Word of God. I said, Lord, that's a lot of books. It's a lot of things. He said, but I'm the everything. He said, I want you to say this and I want you to tell the people because I don't want it to be a question as to whether or not I'm able to be what they need. I am their everything. And so I refuse out of maybe an area of my life that I don't understand. I heard a pastor say this. I refuse to go to hell over a mystery. Some things I don't know why have happened in my life. Sometimes I don't know why certain, you know, offenses or things and or just mishaps take place. But I know this. My God's a good God. My God loves me. And he's faithful. He's faithful, guys. Listen, this is not, we're not getting religious here. We're confessing and declaring the goodness of God, his faithfulness. So I want to take a moment and lead a prayer with y'all. How you doing? What's your name?
Simon.
I've met you before. Good to see you, Simon. You know, brother. Confession of her lips, strengthening her. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Church, I want to pray this morning. Let's stretch every hand to every person. I want to say this as this is our confession. This is our declaration. Is that as of today, we're done with the old. And as of today, we declare all things new. So I want you to say this prayer with me. Say, Dear Heavenly Father, all that I am, I give to you. And all that you are, I receive as mine. Jesus, I confess you today as Christ, as Savior, as Lord over my life. I thank you for forgiving me of my sins. I thank you for making my life new. I thank you that the same power that raised you from the dead is inside of me. I have resurrecting power. This is my confession today. I love you, Lord. I give my life to you. Amen. Amen. I want to encourage you this morning. God loves you so much. So very much. Not one person's here by accident or mistake. This is not about religion or being religious or just trying to do a thing on Easter. This is about knowing that when I stand for Jesus, he stands for me and he's with me. Your best days are the ones that are ahead of you and not behind you. And today we celebrate life in Christ Jesus. We've got a wonderful couple over here. They would just like a few moments of your time. If you do not have a physical Bible, we'll place one in your hands. But they would like to just share some information, encourage you, continue to pray with you. If you could do me a favor, take a moment and just step over this way. This is George and Phyllis. They're leaders here at the church. And so I would ask you at this time, if you can just take a moment and step over and be with them. Church, can we celebrate this morning? Listen, it's Easter Sunday, but more significantly, it's Resurrection Sunday. And I believe that if Peter was able to step out and declare that you are the Christ out of a confession, boldness, I think it would only be fitting that on this Resurrection Sunday that we concluded this time confessing, standing, praising, and shouting, because he's a good God, amen? And so in a moment, the team's going to play and we're going to shout our way out of here. It's Easter Sunday. So glad that each and every single one of you were with us this morning. I want to encourage, if I can share this as a quick announcement. Last week, we had a wonderful time for those that were with us. As we concluded our Palm Sunday service, we sowed an offering, an Easter offering, going towards our new building. If you didn't know, we're building new facility here at the church. Praise God, praise Jesus. We're adding 15,000 square feet of new building space so that our children, first and foremost, can have a premier facility. I know many of you have had to bring your children into the service, and our heart's desire is to be able to make provision so that we can serve our children well. Again, I thought our children's choir did phenomenal this morning, what God is doing in our children's ministry. And that's just one piece of the puzzle. We're expanding our church lobby. We're adding more room for us to be able to do fellowship and do life and grow in Jesus. And so last week, we gave towards that. And what's come in so far, by the way, I'm so excited. We've had over $100,000 go towards the new building project. That's something to praise God towards. You did that. We did that as the church. That's why he says that I'm going to build my church. When we gave, we made our confession. And so, church, I just want to say thank you for those that have joined in on that. If you haven't had an opportunity, you can still give towards that. You're welcome. We'll be around here at the end of the service. I'll pray with you if you'd like me to pray with you for that. But there still is opportunity that if you want to give that Easter offering, you can do that. But I'm just excited about what the Lord is doing. This is a marvelous and a wonderful day today. And I'm so glad that we get to lift up the name of Jesus. I said we get to lift up the name of Jesus. So if you can stand to your feet. And as our team begins to play and as we dismiss, we Remember, God's a good God. He loves you. He wants to bless you. Have a wonderful, happy Easter, happy resurrection. And remember, our confession is that He is Christ, the Son of the living God.